Good afternoon. Hello. Oh, lively cloud. Hello. 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 Just a couple housekeeping items, which I'm sure you've heard in every single session so far. Please turn off your phones or put them on vibrate. No video recording. Please don't make me yell at you. Thank you. And then we have a tight timeline. So after the session, if you can just grab your trash, there's a barrel at the back. I think that's about it. If there's questions, we have a mic up here, or raise your hand and I'll come running with the handheld. And here we go. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Good afternoon. Welcome to Global Regulatory Trends in Privacy and Cybersecurity for 2019. We're going to talk today about the rapid development of privacy law, particularly in the US, including proposed legislation, the political environment, and how clients are really, and companies are dealing with this uncertainty and often conflicting regimes and sort of attempts to harmonize these regimes. I'm Natasha Cohn. I'm the firm-wide head of cybersecurity and data protection and data privacy at the law firm of Aiken Gump, Strauss, Hauer & Feld. And I'm here with my two esteemed panelists. April, could you please introduce yourself?
Hi, everyone. I'm April Doss. I am also the chair firm-wide of cybersecurity and privacy for the law firm I work at, which is Saul Ewing, Arnstein & Lair. Prior to that, I was senior minority counsel for the Senate Intelligence Committee and also head of intelligence law at the National Security Agency.
Good afternoon. My name is Bill Rogers. I'm the firm-wide chair of data privacy and security for Prince Lobel in Boston.
Thank you. So before we start, I want to welcome people to answer questions. I think we all are asked questions. I think we all agree that an interactive session is a better session. Before we kick it off, can you please raise your hand if you are an IT professional? Okay. A lawyer? A compliance officer? I guess that means other. Other. Okay, just a few more. Got it. Okay. So, Bill, why don't you kick it off for us? I think the GDPR has really made an impact on shaping privacy legislation in the U.S. Can you highlight some of those principles for us, both in terms of new laws and proposed legislation across the U.S.?
Sure. Thanks, Natasha. Good afternoon, everybody. All right, so there's been a lot of programming at RSA this week on GDPR. We're not really gonna talk about GDPR, rather we're gonna flip it and talk about apparent influence that GDPR has had on recent, or let's say post-GDPR, domestic legislation, including laws that have been passed and also some bills that are pending both at the federal level and more predominantly at the state level. One of the things that I've addressed in the past, together with April, in fact, at last year's RSA conference, was our strong belief that we need to have global harmonization of data privacy and security laws. And I assume that most everybody, regardless of whether you're an IT professional or a lawyer or what have you, understand and appreciate why that is a laudable goal that we have to achieve. In the shorter term, what we see happening is in this succession of domestic laws and domestic legislation, a slower progression whereby each regime is borrowing and being informed by regimes that have preceded it, including GDPR, but also other US domestic regimes. And so what we can see is some common themes emerging in all these regimes that hopefully will repeat themselves as we go forward and eventually hopefully culminate in some sweeping federal legislation, which will hopefully prevent us from going down the road in privacy law, where we unfortunately went in data breach notification law. We had 50 plus data breach notification statutes, and now we have three fairly sweeping consumer privacy statutes or legislative bills that are pending. I'm going to talk about those. But there's also been a wave of sector-specific regulations or statutes that I think also have borrowed from GDPR. So we'll touch on those. And I believe Natasha and April will also talk about some of these regimes in slightly different contexts. So we know that GDPR was enacted last year, but it was first introduced in 2016. And what happened subsequent to 2016 was we had a succession of regimes. So we had the New York State Department of Financial Services Cybersecurity Regulation 500, which became effective. It came out 5 months after GDPR was announced, but it became effective in March of 2017. Then a short time after that, we had the National Association of Insurance Commissioners introduce their model insurance data security law, which was introduced in December of 2017. Then we had the Cambridge Analytica scandal in the spring of 2018. And you recall the testimony of Mark Zuckerberg on Capitol Hill and the outcry about Facebook and its sharing of data with Cambridge Analytica, and that resulted in the Social Media Privacy and Protection Act of 2018, which came out in April of 2018. Then in June of 2018, we had California Consumer Privacy Act, the CCPA. And recently, in January of this year, we've had two more state privacy laws proposed. One in Washington, which came out around, I believe, January 10th of 2019. And then my home state of Massachusetts followed with a similar law on January 30th of 2019. So we're going to look at these things, and I want to start by talking about the privacy regimes, and then we'll talk a little bit about how the sector-specific security regimes have been influenced by GDPR. So next slide. On the next series of slides, you're going to see references to the California statute, also the Washington legislation and the Massachusetts legislation. We wanted to give you citations that you can use after the program in your own time if you want to explore some of the specific details. We clearly don't have the time to delve into each one of these regimes in incredible detail. But what I want to do is talk about some key themes. They began with GDPR and they run through these state regimes. The first is the Article 15 right under GDPR for access to data by the data subject or the consumer in the case of these three statutes or bills. All of these statutes give the consumer the right to obtain the data that has been collected concerning them, what types of data has been collected, how it was collected, what the business purpose was for its collection, and also who it has been shared or sold to, and what the business reason behind that transaction was. And so, you know, again, GDPR has two principal components, transparency and accountability. And so this right is consistent with the transparency theme of GDPR that runs through all these regimes. All these statutes apply to for-profit entities. So they're somewhat narrower than GDPR, which includes all organizations, not just for-profit organizations. But these statutes focus on for-profit entities, at least for the time being. All of them protect the rights of natural-born residents of each specific state. Natural person rights, I should say, of residents of their states. All of them also have potential extraterritorial effect, depending upon whether foreign or out-of-state businesses are targeting the natural person resident consumers of the governed states. Most of the statutes have thresholds of activity in terms of revenue generation, in terms of the number of resident consumers whose data they collect. And these vary slightly from statute to statute, but they all have those threshold requirements. The Washington statute, if passed, will become effective on December 31st of 2020, so approximately 1 year after the effective date of the CCPA. And the Mass statute, which was just introduced 2 weeks after the Washington statute, won't become effective until January 1st of 2023. Next slide. The next theme that comes from GDPR is the right to erasure, or the right to be deleted from the data controller or the owner of the data. It's also known as the right to be forgotten. All of these regimes incorporate the same right. The principle behind erasure is fundamentally, you know, you have to tell the consumer what the purpose is in gathering the data, and then once your purpose is fulfilled, you really don't have any legal justification to retain the data. And in those circumstances, when the consumer requests that they be deleted or released, or erased rather, you have to grant that request. You have to do it reasonably quickly. You have to confirm that you've done it to the consumer. And most importantly, you have to communicate downstream the consumer's instructions to either the processors that you have working on your data or any third parties to whom you have shared or sold the data to. And the laws all presume that you will carry out that process and enforce it by virtue of the contractual relationships that exist between you, your processors, and any third parties to whom you've sold the data to. So again, fundamentally, if the customer asks to be erased or deleted, you have to do it. I will tell you that all the statutes have carve-outs. If you need the data because you're using it as part of an investigation, fine, you might be able to retain it for a period of time. If you need the data because you're in the midst of some kind of a legal dispute and you need the data for purposes of your case or your defense, most of the statutes allow you to retain it for that purpose. You can also retain the data if you're using it as part of a authorized research study, which for the most part has to be serving the public interest. It can't be necessarily serving your own private entity interests. So those are examples of the incorporation of the right to delete or erase. Next slide. GDPR's Article 20, right to data portability, has also been incorporated as a thread that runs through all these themes. What that means basically is the customer or the consumer has the right to request the information from you, and they need to receive it in the form of an easily understandable report. You have to produce the report under all these regimes in a specified number of days. In, I believe, Washington and California, you have 45 days, or you have to tell the consumer within that first 45 days that you need an extension. You get an extra 45-day extension. The Mass statute requires you, I believe, no, I have that wrong. So it's Washington that has 30 days with a 60-day extension. Massachusetts and California both have 45 and 45 days. Sorry about that. But the important thing here is consumers have a right to get the report. They need to be able to verify the accuracy of the data, and it has to come to them in a form that's readily transferable by them to other data controllers or processors or third parties so that they can help ensure that there's uniform accuracy to the data that's maintained about them by everybody. All of these statutes make you give the reports essentially for free up to once or twice within the first 12 months. A couple of the statutes afford you a defense to refuse to produce in the face of abusive or excessive requests by a particular consumer. And in some cases, you can charge reasonable fees for more than the required number of reports. Next page. GDPR has an Article 21 right to object or to opt out from the sharing of personal information about the data subject. And again, all of these regimes have incorporated that right in some form. This allows the consumer to easily opt out, usually of the sale of their information. Although in the Washington statute, you have two levels of opting out. You can initially opt out by restricting processing of your data, and then you can fully opt out if for any reason the data that is being processed is being used for direct marketing efforts or profiling for purposes of targeted marketing and targeted advertising. So in those circumstances, you have an absolute right to opt out. Generally, if a consumer asks for the opt-out remedy, the business has to respect that for at least 12 months. They can opt back in within the 12 months, but you cannot have solicited that from them. So I think that's a good summary of those particular statutes. Last but not least, with respect to some of the sector-specific regimes that I referenced, all of them have incorporated the GDPR Article 33 72-hour breach notification requirement. Anybody that works in the field will tell you that this is an incredibly onerous requirement. It requires full compliance. It requires the existence of a ready to implement breach incident response plan, and it requires a very coordinated and detailed effort. New York State came out with this, then the NAIC adopted it as part of their model law. That law has now been enacted in South Carolina and Ohio. It's pending in a couple of other states, I believe North Carolina and Michigan. And even the federal Senate bill, in response to the Cambridge Analytica Facebook scandal, brought forward and incorporated 72-hour breach notification standard. So these are some of the themes. Obviously, there are a lot of others, but this is just to give you a flavor that GDPR is informing these regimes, and they are informing one another, particularly California informing the actions of other states. April.
Thanks, Bill. So Bill discussed the impact of the GDPR, which really influenced the CCPA and other state laws. And in fact, the CCPA was such a game changer for sparking activity at the federal level. And it's amazing what a domino effect these statutes have had. And you know, many of you probably already know the triggers that led to the CCPA. This is not going to be a CCPA session. So I'm just going to mention a couple of the major triggers. Really, one of the most important factors in getting the CCPA passed was the Cambridge Analytica scandal, probably not surprisingly. But they really mobilized the privacy advocates and the allegations that 50 million Facebook profiles were harvested and data used to allegedly influence American voters without their consent. You did have the Yahoo breach, the Uber breach, the Equifax breach, and all of these breaches could be sort of case studies in and of themselves and sort of outside the scope of this topic. But it was really the, being on the ground in California, you could really feel that the privacy advocates were most concerned about the Cambridge Analytica scandal. So, of course, the privacy advocates were then, as a result of that, able to get behind what was ultimately the catalyst of the CCPA. So how many of you know Alistair McTaggart? How many of you heard of him? Have you heard of your story? Great, okay. So I wasn't gonna repeat the story. I think a lot of you probably know that ultimately he was the one who got you know, data privacy measures on the ballots for Americans to, for Californians to vote on, and which ultimately led to push to the legislation. Another factor that many companies had that really was a factor in sparking this federal legislation was that the GDPR, companies started implementing the GDPR, and they realized that businesses were not collapsing due to the compliance of GDPR. And if you look at the surveys, about 50% of companies are saying that they're compliant with the GDPR, that, you know, considering that it should have been implemented in May of last year. I'll let you guys see if you think that that's a good or bad thing. Some people actually argue that it's impossible to be fully compliant with the GDPR, but you know, bottom line is that we are really seeing businesses more cognizant and attentive more than ever about where their personal data is and what they're doing with it. So. And if you look at this from an economic perspective, you know, we now have the world's second and the world's fifth largest economies governed by strict privacy protection regimes. And if you look at it from that perspective and you are a significant company, you know, it's highly likely you're going to fall under one or both of these legislations. And I have a client of a global company who said, I don't want to deal with these statutes. Can I just delete all my data? And I had to gently mention that the CCPA and the GDPR both apply to employees, and I had assumed he wasn't going to fire his employees as well. So the point is that, you know, sort of this is the new normal, and you know, we've got to live with it. So. So now we're post CCPA. We are post midterms elections. You've got the Democrats taking a majority of the House. You have Republicans kept the Senate. And we'll talk later about why Pelosi is, you know, really a key factor in kind of aligning the California Democrats when it comes to this federal policy legislation. You have more than 30 bills that are pending at the moment in Congress relating to privacy issues, but many of these bills are not bipartisan. So I think the big takeaway is that we expect to see a draft bipartisan privacy bill coming out of Senate Commerce either this month or next month. So keep your eye on Senate Commerce. They seem to be taking the lead. And of course, the million-dollar question is this bill going to pass? And that's always a dangerous thing to bet on Congress. But it is a rare moment that we're seeing such bipartisan support. And you're also seeing some unusual alignment. So I'm going to talk about that for a moment. You're seeing the Republicans in the Senate drive this bill. Senator Wicker is the Senate Commerce Chairman is taking the lead. Senate Moran is also involved. But you have also Democrats who want this too. Some of the Democrats feel they want to rein in the sort of practices of some of the tech companies. And Democrat Senator Blumenthal, who's very pro-consumer advocate from Connecticut, and an interesting senator from Hawaii, Senator Schatz, who is really seen as a thought leader. He's a young, tech-savvy guy, and we think he's going to be a bit of a deal maker. You probably know that there were hearings in the House and the Senate on privacy just last week. There's also been hearings prior to that. And then now you've got the Senate Judiciary sort of thrown their hat in the ring. They announced that they're holding a hearing next week on the GDPR and the CCPA. So it looks like there might be a little bit of a turf war going on. And I think a little competition in Congress might be a good thing. You also have industry in favor of this. Obviously, you know, businesses don't want to see a patchwork of 50 states, you know, and all the inconsistencies in dealing with these privacy statutes. And for example, you know, the telecommunications industry says, you know, look, we're already heavily regulated and other companies are not, so we want to see this happen. And then if you look at the administration, you know, Trump is a populist president. You know, do you see him, you know, vetoing a privacy bill? The administration is not too active, at least, but I think given sort of Trump's stance, he seems to be staying neutral or not really commenting. And then finally, we actually seem to have a perceived a deadline. If you take into the fact that the CCPA is to be enacted January 1 of 2020, You know, you can argue that, you know, if we don't get this done by January 1, 2020, when most of the CCPA provisions take effect, you know, then has the train left the station and can we preempt this? So, of course, we can expect some stumbling blocks. I think you've got the California Dems that are very protective and sensitive about the CCPA and privacy generally, and we'll see if others can get them to the table. And this is where, you know, Nancy Pelosi comes in. No one knows the California Dems better than anyone, and we'll see if she can play a role in really reining them in. And then California Dems are also playing hardball. They're saying, you know, we don't want preemption. So is this a negotiation tactic? And will they sort of cave on that point? And you know, the Republicans want preemption, and but they don't seem to want to give, they generally don't want to give government more authority. So we'll see on the issue of the FTC and whether the FTC can be given more rulemaking authority and more authority to fine companies the first time through. We'll see if the Republicans can kind of give on that. And then other hurdles include the privacy advocates, a very active, vocal group. So, April, I think you might want to add to some of these views on the federal policy side.
Yeah, absolutely. If we can move on to the next slide. Yeah. So Natasha's already touched on most of the points on this particular slide, but I'm going to skip down to the bottom. If you think back, and just let me step back for a minute. If you think back about six years ago, all of the talk down on the Hill was, in terms of cybersecurity, was around a national data breach law. Remember, we didn't yet have data breach laws in all 50 states yet. And in the during the time frame of the discussions that led up to CISA, to the Cybersecurity Information Sharing Act, there was some conversation about whether we need a national breach law. What's happened since we've had GDPR come online, since we've had CCPA get passed, is we've seen the momentum really shift. And now what we're talking about, now everything that's in discussion, is a much broader and more comprehensive privacy law that, yes, would address, you know, breach notification and timelines and you know, what constitutes personal data and things like that, but also questions around individual consumer or data subject rights to opt out and have access to data and right of deletion and so forth. So the conversation has really shifted. And one of the things that I think makes that interesting is that, you know, policy kind of abhors a vacuum. And so if we don't see federal legislation coming out of Congress, for all the reasons that Natasha talked about, jurisdictional squabbles between committees in each chamber of commerce, Congress, prioritization, right? Congress has a lot of things they want to get to. Maybe a privacy bill isn't going to be what makes the cut. For all these reasons, if we don't see federal privacy legislation, we will still nonetheless see other actors continue to move the ball forward on these topics in the same way that we already have. So really, I think what we're going to see is the continued impact of class action litigation, consumer class action litigation, and derivative litigation, action by state attorneys general, both individual and multi-state, and model laws. And so I just want to briefly touch on a couple examples of each of those. If you think about the consumer class action context, of course, we've had consumer class action lawsuits based on data breach going back to, you know, Target and Home Depot and Anthem and all the big names. Those multi-district litigations are still wending their way through federal court. In some cases, they've now been settled. We're still going to see those cases move forward. What's a little bit different with the litigation we're now seeing, the consumer class action litigation against Facebook for the sharing of data with Cambridge Analytica, is that we're seeing some different theories around what the cause of action is, and we're seeing a lot of discussion and debate in courts around whether or not you need to be able to point to monetary damage for standing to sue, but also monetary consequences in terms of things like compromise of a social security number or payment card information, things like that, in order to be able to show damages. When you think about the data that is at stake in the Facebook Cambridge Analytica case, you're talking about data that our prior laws had not really addressed. things that many people would consider to be very personal, like photos and membership in private groups and non-public groups and, you know, political affiliation and sexual orientation and mental health and, you know, all kinds of things that have not been recognized by the state data breach laws. So we're going to continue to see consumer advocates using litigation as one means of trying to move these theories forward, even if it takes a number of cases to get there. Certainly, we are also seeing, we're seeing directors and officers of corporations get a wake-up call from some of this derivative litigation. So when you look at something like the Equifax litigation, there is the piece of litigation that's consumer litigation against Equifax. There's also the piece against the directors and officers alleging that they failed to carry out their obligations in making sure that Equifax had robust cybersecurity measures in place. And so in a decision just a couple weeks ago, what we saw is the federal court allow the case, the derivative case against Equifax officers, to go forward as to one particular executive in the company, because that executive had been out there, you know, publicly saying, cybersecurity is the thing that keeps me up at night and we're very concerned about it, while he knew that there was a data breach, at least according to the allegations. So the idea, the prospect that individual directors and officers could be held personally liable for these data breaches is absolutely the kind of thing that gets people's attention and focuses more attention on how effectively the cybersecurity preparedness and data privacy measures are being carried out. And I would argue that that kind of derivative litigation is going to have every bit as much impact in getting companies' attention as SEC guidelines, right? So AGs, state attorney generals, of course, are all over this. You know, they've been filing consumer protection lawsuits based on data privacy and cybersecurity claims for, you know, years now. And one of the things that we've seen now, December, January, is that we're moving from a situation in which many individual state AGs are filing claims against the same big corporate defendants over their privacy or cyber practices, to now actually consolidated multi-state joint claims by state AGs. The one that was recently filed is believed to be the first one. It seems to be the first one. And it was against a data broker that had a breach of about 3.9 million patient records relating to HIPAA-covered data. So what we see is policy and law kind of abhor a vacuum. And that vacuum is not going to last very long. If there's not federal legislation, there'll be something else. The last example that's up here on this slide is the context of model laws. Bill already talked about Reg 500 in the New York Department of Financial Services. Of course, with New York's heft and weight in the financial services sector, Reg 500 punches well above its weight in terms of a state cybersecurity measure. And one of the things that's so interesting about Reg 500 is it doesn't just focus on the privacy aspect of cybersecurity, it also requires covered entities to protect operational data. So it's really calling out specifically the importance of maintaining continuity of operations in the financial services sector, as well as protection of PII. And so what we saw was, in part of that financial services sector, in the insurance sector, the National Association of Insurance Commissioners had been looking for a while at cybersecurity issues. They had a few years ago a draft model law that looked quite a bit different. Once Reg 500 came out, NAIC really shifted focus. The model law got revised so that there is now a model law that has been adopted by this nationwide association of insurance commissioners that says any state should consider adopting this law, which looks a lot like Reg 500, to apply to all of the insurance licensed entities in their state. So again, you know, Natasha's talked about all the complexity at the federal level. We will still see all of these other conversations and types of action moving the ball forward and trying to drive it in different directions at the below federal level, while the federal discussions are ongoing.
Okay, so I think we're going to shift gears a little bit. We don't have a federal law yet. And so as you know, we've been discussing, this obviously creates a tremendous amount of uncertainty. And so, April, the amount of uncertainty that our clients face across the board, you know, continues to be a challenge. And, you know, because privacy laws touch upon so many different industries and areas of businesses, can you tell us a little bit about this uncertainty and how it's impacting your clients on a daily basis?
Let me just ask for the room. How many of you feel like this is just a tangled quagmire, and if you could get a straight answer on anything, that would be helpful. And if maybe your straight answers didn't directly conflict with each other, that would also be helpful. So for what it's worth, and thank you for all the raised hands, I feel your pain. I think we all do. I think this is a shared pain. And you know, what I think we're all seeing is that the only effective way to navigate all of this uncertainty and all of this complexity and all of this conflict and overlap is to have a really joint interdisciplinary approach to how to tackle these questions. It's my firm belief that the only way to make progress internal to any organization on these things is to have a really tight working relationship amongst technology architecture, design and development, privacy and compliance, and legal and policy, and business operations. You really need to have kind of all those pieces coming together to look at this. And I know we're running short on time, so I'm only going to touch quickly on some of these. You know, once upon a time, it was the case that in many regulated sectors, if you were regulated under HIPAA, if you were regulated under GLBA, you primarily had to worry about your regulations. And what we're seeing is that that's really no longer the case. Almost everybody now has to comply with multiple kinds of regulations and laws. And the challenge for data governance, the challenge for data mapping, the challenge for identifying data objects that are being put into analytics and spitting out behavioral profiles or predictive algorithms or, you know, predictive conclusions from algorithms, all those things are really hard to rack and stack. You sort of need one of these multidimensional matrices to do it. And so, you know, I think that that's been kind of the big shift. And I'm going to skip past, because we're running short on time, I'm going to skip past the rest of this slide, except to say that, I think we're just going to skip this slide. Because there's so much to talk about here. Can I just tell you, when we were putting this program together and we thought, oh, global trends in privacy and cybersecurity, we can do that in 50 minutes. Yeah, we knew we couldn't.
45, actually.
Yeah. So, all right. So increasing complexity, study of a case law. Because CCPA is so much in the news and so much on everybody's mind, I'm just going to touch quickly on a few points here. I know there's been other sessions this week about CCPA where this is not a deep dive. But to give you a couple of examples of things you may already be thinking about, there is a carve-out in CCPA that says that for GLBA covered, that's Gramm-Leach-Bliley covered entities, and for HIPAA covered entities, they don't have to be concerned about compliance with CCPA for that data, the GLBA covered data or the HIPAA data. What we're finding, what I'm finding in conversations with my clients, is if they're a healthcare covered entity, they are realizing they have a lot of personal data, as defined by this very broad definition under CCPA, that's not PHI. So their business associate agreements don't address these issues. How they handle it from a technical perspective, workflow process, network segmentation, protections, all of those things does not address the non-PHI data, because they haven't had to think about this before. They had to comply with HIPAA for PHI. They didn't have to be concerned about marketing information, about website visit information, about all the kinds of things that are starting to arise under GDPR if they're subject to it and under CCPA. Similarly, in the financial services sector, all of the big financial institutions that are really well accustomed to dealing with Gramm-Leach-Bliley compliance have focused really intently on careful governance of the data that's associated with financial transactions or applications for customer status and things like that. But these questions around all the data relating to a consumer or household that is covered by CCPA, that's quite different. So where you've got data brokers that are making information available that a financial institution might use for marketing purposes or those kinds of softer touch kind of purposes, not governed by GLBA, subject to CCPA, at least in its current form, and creating a lot of challenges. And so, again, I think the big sort of story, if you will, is this shift where it used to be in a regulated sector. If you complied with your regulations, you were probably in a pretty good space, and nobody has that luxury anymore. So if we pop over to this next slide, you know, here's just a couple of examples of all of, you know, the ways that these things bump into each other. So, you know, for example, you know, what does it mean to sell data under CCPA? Really unclear. A lot of folks are struggling with that. Personal information or data, well, you know, a lot of these statutes govern personal information if you're CCPA, personal data if you're GDPR, if you have to comply with GDPR, if you have to comply with Reg 500, you have to protect your operational data and apply your cybersecurity regime to that. Subject consumer and household, you know, we've touched on that a bit. IPs, cookies, and browsing, all of these types of data that are really new challenges. And I know I'm pretty sure Natasha's going to talk a bit about the challenges around sensitive data that is sometimes restricted for purposes of collection and processing under GDPR, like ethnicity and political orientation or political and philosophical beliefs and things like that, versus the need to keep some of that, those kinds of data, particularly around race and ethnicity in an employment context. So some of these So let's just say this. This tile map could be built out almost infinitely. I think we've got Natasha about to talk about some of those conflicts and collisions.
Yeah, I think slide 16 could be talked about for hours. So I'm just going to touch a little bit on sort of these conflicting data privacy regimes and talk a little bit about sort of just, again, we're running out of time. So I'm just going to give you two examples of how, you know, practically speaking, you might be dealing with multiple privacy regimes and they're sort of conflicting with each other and what do you do? First off, I think, I thought this picture expressed the frustration that my clients feel about data privacy today. And, regularly, I think clients are now saying, look, you know, we're fed up. Can you create a data privacy framework for us that hits the highest common denominator? Even if we have to, that means, you know, we have to hold to a higher standard. We just don't know what regulation is going to be coming out next. And this is not just about the U.S., obviously. This is about globally as well. They're having the same issues. So first off, I think, you know, conflicting laws in the area of data privacy is not a new thing. You know, years ago when we would conduct investigations overseas, you know, we dealt with local countries' data privacy laws, and we'd end up sending teams of people to interview people, and then we'd try to gather documents, and we'd figure out legal mechanisms to get the data across the borders. But nowadays, you know, we have so much more and stronger data localization laws, and so the growth of these laws have really put this issue sort of front and center. And we've certainly been in situations where our clients, you know, really have to choose between violating a local law, a local data privacy law or secrecy law, confidentiality law, or being in violation of a U.S. court order and risk being in contempt, or violating a subpoena from the Department of Justice. This happens, and it's a severe situation, and it's some of the hardest calls you really have to make. Another example is really the issue of sensitive data. And I think, you know, privacy is really very personal. It's very connected to culture. And so it's not uncommon that there are conflicts. And one of the examples I like to relay to demonstrate this is in the context of drones. So for example, in some jurisdictions, you know, drones are outfitted with cameras and, you know, they're considered extensions of law enforcement and public safety. But, you know, in other cultures, drones with cameras are prohibited because the very act of taking someone's picture without consent can be considered severely invasive and at times could be considered a crime. So that, I hope that gives you an indication of how I think, you know, privacy is very connected to culture. And so if you look at the GDPR, let's take the issue of biometrics. So biometrics under the CCPA is considered personal information and it doesn't require any special treatment. That's not necessarily what the CCPA is there for. You also have BIPA, which is a Illinois state statute on biometrics. This is considered the gold standard by the Electronic Frontier Foundation. And even with this gold standard, you know, BIPA and other regulations in the US, they permit the collection and use of biometric data, and then you're required to build safeguards around that use. But this is in sharp contrast to how the GDPR really approaches, you know, biometrics. You know, under Article 9, for example, biometric data is among sort of the special categories, and what that means is that you're prohibited from actually processing that data unless certain exceptional circumstances apply. And so if you represent, you know, if you're an airline, for example, and you can see how biometric data is treated very differently in different jurisdictions. And if you're an airline and you're trying to use biometric data increasingly, which I think airlines are doing, to help enhance the customer sort of travel experience, then, you know, you have some hurdles. And if you think you're, some airlines think they're exempt under federal law, and they don't have to necessarily apply with a BIPA, but what about the GDPR? You know, so they have quite a few things to grapple with. So April mentioned race and ethnicity. I don't have too much time to get into that, but race and ethnicity is also a special category under Article 9 of the GDPR. And in the US, you know, you're required as an employer to keep that type of data on file and maintain it when it comes to your US employees. So if you're a multinational employer and you employ US citizens in Europe and you have to comply with federal laws that require you to keep data like ethnicity and race on file, and it's really not clear if you have an exception under the GDPR to do so. So these are some of the practical examples. I have a few more if you want to talk afterwards, but I think we're running a little bit out of time, so I'm going to move to Bill. Why don't you tell us a little bit about the uptick in litigation?
All right, well, you know, I'm not sure there's necessarily been an uptick in litigation, but there's certainly going to be more viable litigation for a couple of reasons. Number one, traditionally, in order for plaintiffs to bring claims under common law or under federal statutes, even if the federal statutes entitled claimants to pursue what are called statutory damages, which are a statutorily mandated sum of money for a violation of the statute as opposed to somebody's actual damages. In the common law cases, you've always had to be able to establish some kind of a tangible harm. Depending upon the nature of the common law claims, it was either a loss of money or property, or in the case of tort claims, you'd have to show bodily injury or property damage in order to have standing to bring your case. In the federal realm, Article 3 of the Constitution requires that a plaintiff have an injury in fact in order to have access to the federal courts. A lot of these cases for breaches of data or cybersecurity breaches have failed because of lack of standing. And so what we're seeing now is legislators responding to that. And in the case of the CCPA, initially, they granted a private right of action for plaintiffs, including class actions, for exfiltration or unauthorized access to a subset of personal information protected by the California Breach Notification Statute as well as CCPA. Now, in February of this year, a proposed amendment to the CCPA has been introduced to allow that private right of action to expand to all of the statute's requirements. In other words, it's no longer just in the narrow breach context. Now it's a violation of any of the statute's provisions can prompt an action. By the same token, the new Massachusetts statute that I alluded to earlier specifically provides that any violation of the provisions of the statute constitute an injury in fact, and there is no further harm necessary for a successful plaintiff. We don't have a lot of time to talk about it, but under BIPA, the Biometric Information Privacy Act that Natasha alluded to, the Illinois Supreme Court handed down a decision in January of this year. It's called Rosenbach versus Six Flags. You should look at it. And it's significant because BIPA is a relatively mature statute. It's been around for 12 or 13 years. And yet this matter of first impression presented itself because Six Flags was capturing a thumbprint from customers who wanted to purchase a season pass. That way, anytime the customer returned, they would just have they'd present their pass, they'd have their thumb scanned to verify that it was them, and they would go. The problem was BIPA required that in order to capture that thumbprint, you had to notify the person in advance that you were capturing it. You'd have to tell them the purpose why you were doing that. You'd have to tell them the duration of time that you intended to hold that thumbprint and get a signed release from the customer in order to do it. Six Flags did none of those things. And so the case was brought by the mother of a boy, a 14-year-old boy who went to Six Flags, got his season pass, had his thumb scanned, had no harm whatsoever. But theoretically, that was a technical violation of BIPA. The district court dismissed the case. The district court said that the case could go forward. The appellate court said, no, dismissed, there's no harm here. You need some kind of harm, some kind of additional adverse effect on the plaintiff in order to proceed with the claim. But the Illinois Supreme Court reversed the intermediate appellate court and said, wrong. This is a statute. We're talking about biometric information, which is unique among all of the personal identifiable information that's out there. The one thing that none of us can change is our biometric information. We're born with it. And so unlike a Social Security number or your credit card number, you can't replace it. You can't change it. Once it's been unlawfully obtained and subject to the risk of breach, you're going to be irreparably harmed. And so the Illinois Supreme Court found that the state legislature wanted there to be a remedy for mere violations of the statute for that reason. So it's a very interesting case.
Yep. Well, thank you very much.
Questions?
Do we have time for questions? Or?
Couple minutes.
Fine.
Well, they're coming down.
Thank you very much for your rendition of all this complexity. For the general counsel or the chief legal officer within a particular firm, what would you say is best practice in order to come to terms with this complexity?
If I had to say just one thing, it would be make sure that there's an interdisciplinary approach to complying with all of these laws. There is far too much risk. Without that interdisciplinary approach, there's too much risk of procurement officers making decisions in an absence of guidance from the technology experts, the architecture being developed without talking to the compliance officers, everybody making decisions that don't make sense from a business operations perspective. It has to be interorganizational, cross-organizational, cross-functional in order to be effective.
Yeah, and I would add to that what we were saying earlier, which is if it's really best practice that you're striving for, you want to take a step back, understand your privacy frameworks across different jurisdictions, and then try to adopt something that you think ultimately will be sort of at the highest standard so that you're not constantly sort of switching things up in different jurisdictions. If the culture of your organization actually will allow for that.
I would add to that, it's not just what your culture allows. I agree with the highest common denominator approach to best practices. But ultimately, it's the highest common denominator that you can afford. and we can't forget the affordability factor. When we talk about that, you know, 50% of organizations are not GDPR compliant or consider themselves not to be GDPR compliant, a lot of that is because of cost and the fear that compliance will be too expensive. And that's
some of it. Some of it has to do with wanting opt-in and or wanting opt-out and not opt-in, and that's a cultural issue. But that's a very long discussion we can have.
I agree there are cultural issues.
I've got a question. You mentioned the carve-outs for these statutes. Are any of the carve-outs dealing with the issue of the multi-jurisdictional issues, like if you have to retain information, the right to be forgotten, and what if somebody else wants bulk data retention in another country? Mm-hmm. Is anybody looking at the international issues and maybe we need carve-outs for that so that we don't have hefty fines in other countries?
All right, well, so I'll answer. I think all of the state regimes that we talked about today have a carve-out for compliance with federal and, in some cases, other state law. But I'm not sure that it contemplates compliance with foreign law, foreign international law. Do you agree with me?
Yeah. I don't think they're contemplating that.
So I don't think
that's
a carve-out.
But, I mean, I think you have to unpack your question and take each right that Bill mentioned and really analyze each right that the consumers have. So, for example, with respect to deletion, there are 9 exceptions. And some people say that in the CCPA, the exceptions really swallow the rule, that ultimately if a customer comes to you and says, please delete X, Y, and Z, if you wanted to as a business, you might be able to draft up a policy that could, you know, reject almost all of the deletion requests because it would fit within an exception. That wouldn't be what I would advise on, but it's, you know, so I guess that you could argue that people understand, you know, that if you give a consumer a right to delete data, you know, you might have to keep it somewhere else, right, for some other reason. And so I think you have to kind of analyze this question on each issue, right? But I do not think at all that they're thinking about, oh, this is what the GDPR does versus what, you know, what they do in China versus what they do in Russia. I don't think anyone's thinking that. Yeah.
So if you have those obligations, it's a problem.
It's a problem.
Thank you very much. Thanks, everybody.